This channel has been established for visually impaired people. For the visually impaired people, voice narration and a written expression are also provided for the hearing impaired. Don't forget to subscribe to our channel. The Norman conquest of England was the 11th century invasion and occupation of England by an army of Norman, Breton, and French soldiers led by Duke William II of Normandy, later styled as William the Conqueror. William's claim to the English throne derived from his familial relationship with the childless Anglo-Saxon King Edward the Confessor, who may have encouraged William's hopes for the throne. Edward died in January 1066 and was succeeded by his brother-in-law Harold Godwinson. The Norwegian King Harald Hardrada invaded northern England in September 1066 and was victorious at the Battle of Fulford, but Harold defeated and killed him at the Battle of Stamford Bridge on 25 September. Within days, William landed in southern England. Harold marched south to confront him, leaving a significant portion of his army in the north. Harold's army confronted William's invaders on 14 October at the Battle of Hastings. William's force defeated Harold, who was killed in the engagement. Although William's main rivals were gone, he still faced rebellions over the following years and was not secure on his throne until after 1072. The lands of the resisting English elite were confiscated. Some of the elite fled into exile to control his new kingdom. William granted lands to his followers and built castles commanding military strongpoints throughout the land. Other effects of the conquest included the court and government, the introduction of Norman French as the language of the elites, and changes in the composition of the upper classes, as William enfeoffed lands to be held directly from the king. More gradual changes affected the agricultural classes and village life. The main change appears to have been the formal elimination of slavery, which may or may not have been linked to the invasion. There was little alteration in the structure of government, as the new Norman administrators took over many of the forms of Anglo-Saxon government. Contents 1. Origins 2. Tostig's raids and the Norwegian invasion 3. Norman invasion 31. Norman preparations and forces 32. Landing and Harold's march south 33. Hastings 34. Aftermath of Hastings 4. English resistance 41. First rebellions 42. Revolts of 1069. 43. Danish troubles 44. Last resistance 5. Control of England 6. Consequences 61. Elite replacement 62. English emigration 63. Governmental systems 64. Language 65. Immigration and intermarriage 66. Society 7. Historiography 8. Notes 9. Citations 10. References 11. External links. Origins 13th century depiction of Rollo and his descendants. William I of Normandy and Richard I of Normandy in 911. The French Carolingian ruler Charles the Simple allowed a group of Vikings under their leader Rollo to settle in Normandy as part of the Treaty of St. Clair sur Epte. In exchange for the land, the Norsemen under Rollo were expected to provide protection along the coast against further Viking invaders. Their settlement proved successful, and the Vikings in the region became known as the Northmen, from which Normandy and Normans are derived. The Normans quickly adopted the indigenous culture, renouncing paganism and converting to Christianity. They adopted the long dioil of their new home and added features from their own Norse language, transforming it into the Norman language. They intermarried with the local population and used the territory granted them as a base to extend the frontiers of the duchy westward, annexing territory including the Besson, the Cotentin Peninsula and Avranches. In 1002, King Æthelred II of England married Emma, the sister of Richard II, Duke of Normandy. Their son Edward the Confessor, who spent many years in exile in Normandy, succeeded to the English throne in 1042. This led to the establishment of a powerful Norman interest in English politics, as Edward drew heavily on his former hosts for support, bringing in Norman courtiers, soldiers, and clerics and appointing them to positions of power, particularly in the church. Childless and embroiled in conflict with the formidable Godwin, Earl of Wessex, and his sons, Edward may also have encouraged Duke William of Normandy's ambitions for the English throne. When King Edward died at the beginning of 1066, the lack of a clear heir led to a disputed succession in which several contenders laid claim to the throne of England. Edward's immediate successor was the Earl of Wessex, Harold Godwinson, the richest and most powerful of the English aristocrats. Harold was elected king by the Witenagemot of England and crowned by the Archbishop of York, Ealdred. Although Norman propaganda claimed the ceremony was performed by Stigand, the uncanonically elected Archbishop of Canterbury. Harold was immediately challenged by two powerful neighbouring rulers. Duke William claimed that he had been promised the throne by King Edward and that that Harald had sworn agreement to this. King Harald III of Norway, commonly known as Harald Hardrada, also contested the succession. His claim to the throne was based on an agreement between his predecessor Magnus I of Norway and the earlier English king, Harthacnut, whereby if either died without heir, the other would inherit both England and Norway. William and Harald at once set about assembling troops and ships to invade England. Tostig's raids and the Norwegian invasion. Main article, Battle of Stamford Bridge. In early 1066, Harald's exiled brother, Tostig Godwinson, raided southeastern England with a fleet he had recruited in Flanders, later joined by other ships from Orkney. Threatened by Harald's fleet, Tostig moved north and raided in East Anglia and Lincolnshire, but he was driven back to his ships by the brothers Edwin, Earl of Mercia, and Morcar, Earl of Northumbria. Deserted by most of his followers, he withdrew to Scotland, where he spent the summer recruiting fresh forces. King Harald spent the summer on the south coast with a large army and fleet waiting for William to invade, but the bulk of his forces were militia who needed to harvest their crops, so on 8 September Harald dismissed them. King Harald Hardrada invaded northern England in early September, leading a fleet of more than 300 ships carrying perhaps 15,000 men. Harald's army was further augmented by the forces of Tostig, who threw his support behind the Norwegian king's bid for the throne. Advancing on York, the Norwegians defeated a northern English army under Edwin and Morcar on 20 September at the Battle of Fulford. The two earls had rushed to engage the Norwegian forces before King Harald could arrive from the south. Although Harald Godwinson had married Edwin and Morcar's sister Ealhgyth, the two earls may have distrusted Harald and feared that the king would replace Morcar with Tostig. The end result was that their forces were devastated and unable to participate in the rest of the campaigns of 1066. Although the two earls survived the battle, Hardrada moved on to York, which surrendered to him after taking hostages from the leading men of the city. On 24 September the Norwegians moved east to the tiny village of Stamford Bridge. King Harald probably learned of the Norwegian invasion in mid-September and rushed north, gathering forces as he went. The royal forces probably took 9 days to cover the distance from London to York, averaging almost 25 miles 40 kilometers per day. At dawn on 25 September Harald's forces reached York, where he learned the location of the Norwegians. The English then marched on the invaders and took them by surprise, defeating them in the Battle of Stamford Bridge. Harald of Norway and Tostig were killed, and the Norwegians suffered such horrific losses that only 24 of the original 300 ships were required to carry away the survivors. The English victory was costly, however, as Harald's army was left in a battered and weakened state, and far from the English Channel. Norman invasion. Norman preparations and forces. William assembled a large invasion fleet and an army gathered from Normandy and all over France, including large contingents from Brittany and Flanders. He mustered his forces at Saint-Valery-sur-Somme and was ready to cross the Channel by about 12 August. The exact numbers and composition of William's force are unknown. A contemporary document claims that William had 726 ships, but this may be an inflated figure. Figures given by contemporary writers are highly exaggerated, varying from 14,000 to 150,000 men. Modern historians have offered a range of estimates for the size of William's forces: 7,000, 8,000 men, 1,000 to 2,000 of them cavalry, 10,000 to 12,000 men, 10,000 men, 3,000 of them cavalry, or 7,500 men. The army would have consisted of a mix of cavalry, infantry, and archers or crossbowmen, with about equal numbers of cavalry and archers, and the foot soldiers equal in number to the other two types combined. Although later lists of companions of William the Conqueror are extant, most are padded with extra names. Only about 35 individuals can be reliably claimed to have been with William at Hastings. William of Poitiers states that William obtained Pope Alexander II's consent for the invasion, signified by a papal banner, along with diplomatic support from other European rulers. Although Alexander did give papal approval to the conquest after it succeeded, no other source claims papal support before the invasion. William's army assembled during the summer while an invasion fleet in Normandy was constructed. Although the army and fleet were ready by early August, adverse winds kept the ships in Normandy until late September. There were probably other reasons for William's delay, including intelligence reports from England revealing that Harald's forces were deployed along the coast. William would have preferred to delay the invasion until he could make an unopposed landing, and Harald's march south landing in England seen from the Bayeux tapestry, depicting ships coming in and horses landing. The Normans crossed to England a few days after Harald's victory over the Norwegians at Stamford Bridge on 25 September. Following the dispersal of Harald's naval force, they landed at Pevensey in Sussex on 28 September and erected a wooden castle at Hastings, from which they raided the surrounding area. This ensured supplies for the army, and as Harold and his family held many of the lands in the area, it weakened William's opponent and made him more likely to attack to put an end to the raiding. Harold, after defeating his brother Tostig and Harald Hardrada in the north, left much of his force there, including Morcar and Edwin, and marched the rest of his army south to deal with the threatened Norman invasion. It is unclear when Harold learned of William's landing, but it was probably while he was traveling south. Harold stopped in London for about a week before reaching Hastings, so it is likely that he took a second week to march south, averaging about 27 miles 43 kilometers per day, for the nearly 200 miles 320 kilometers to London. Although Harold attempted to surprise the Normans, William's scouts reported the English arrival to the Duke. The exact events preceding the battle remain obscure, with contradictory accounts in the sources, but all agree that William led his army from his castle and advanced towards the enemy. Harold had taken up a defensive position at the top of Senlac Hill, present-day Battle, East Sussex, about 6 miles 10 kilometers from William's castle at Hastings. Contemporary sources do not give reliable data on the size and composition of Harold's army, although two Norman sources give figures of 12. But most agree on a range of between 7,000 and 8,000 English troops. These men would have comprised a mix of the feared militia, mainly composed of foot soldiers and the housecarls, or noblemen's personal troops, who usually also fought on foot. The main difference between the two types was in their armor. The housecarls used better protecting armor than that of the feared. The English army does not appear to have had many archers, although some were present. The identities of few of the Englishmen at Hastings are known. The most important were Harold's brothers Gyrth and Leofwine, about 18. Other named individuals can reasonably be assumed to have fought with Harold at Hastings, including two of his other relatives. Hastings' main article, Battle of Hastings, depiction of Harold's death from the Bayeux Tapestry. The battle began at about 9. Norman cavalry then attacked and killed the pursuing troops while the Bretons were fleeing. Rumors swept the Norman forces that the Duke had been killed, but William rallied his troops twice more. The Normans made feigned withdrawals, tempting the English into pursuit, and allowing the Norman cavalry to attack them repeatedly. The available sources are more confused about events in the afternoon, but it appears that the decisive event was the death of Harold, about which differing stories are told. William of Jumieges claimed that Harold was killed by the Duke. The Bayeux Tapestry has been claimed to show Harold's death by an arrow to the eye, but this may be a later reworking of the tapestry to conform to 12th century stories that Harold had died from an arrow wound to the head. Other sources stated that no one knew how Harold died because the press of battle was so tight around the king that the soldiers could not see who struck the fatal blow. William of Poitiers gives no details at all about Harold's death. Aftermath of Hastings. The day after the battle, Harold's body was identified, either by his armor or marks on his body. The bodies of the English dead, who included some of Harold's brothers and his housecarls, were left on the battlefield, although some were removed by relatives later. Jytha, Harold's mother, offered the victorious Duke the weight of her son's body in gold for its custody, but her offer was refused. William ordered that Harold's body be thrown into the sea, but whether that took place is unclear. Another story relates that Harold was buried at the top of a cliff. Waltham Abbey, which had been founded by Harold, later claimed that his body had been buried there secretly. Later legends claimed that Harold did not die at Hastings, but escaped and became a hermit at Chester after his victory at Hastings. William expected to receive the submission of the surviving English leaders, but instead Edgar the Aetheling was proclaimed king by the Witenagemot, with the support of Earls Edwin and Morcar. Stigand, the Archbishop of Canterbury, and Ealdred, the Archbishop of York. William therefore advanced, marching around the coast of Kent to London. He defeated an English force that attacked him at Southwark, but being unable to storm London Bridge, he sought to reach the capital by a more circuitous route. William moved up the Thames Valley to cross the river at Wallingford, Berkshire. While there he received the submission of Stigand. He then travelled northeast along the Chilterns, before advancing towards London from the northwest, fighting further engagements against forces from the city having failed to muster an effective military response. Edgar's leading supporters lost their nerve, and the English leaders surrendered to William at Berkhamsted, Hertfordshire. William was acclaimed King of England and crowned by Ealdred on 25 December 1066. In Westminster Abbey, the new king attempted to conciliate the remaining English nobility by confirming Morcar, Edwin, and Waltheof, the Earl of Northumbria, in their lands as well as Giving some land to Edgar the Atheling, William remained in England until March 1067, when he returned to Normandy with English prisoners, including Stigand, Morcar, Edwin, Edgar the Atheling, and Waltheof. English resistance first rebellions despite the submission of the English nobles, resistance continued for several years. William left control of England in the hands of his half-brother Odo and one of his closest supporters, William Fitzosborne. In 1067, rebels in Kent launched an unsuccessful attack on Dover Castle in combination with Eustace II of Boulogne, the Shropshire landowner Edric the Wild, in alliance with the Welsh rulers of Gwynedd and Powys, raised a revolt in western Mercia, fighting Norman forces based in Hereford. These events forced William to return to England at the end of 1067. Indiana 1068, William besieged rebels in Exeter, including Harold's mother Jytha, and after suffering heavy losses managed to negotiate the town's surrender in May. William's wife Matilda was crowned queen at Westminster, an important symbol of William's growing international stature. Later in the year, Edwin and Morcar raised a revolt in Mercia with Welsh assistance, while Gospatric, the newly appointed Earl of Northumbria, led a rising in Northumbria, which had not yet been occupied by the Normans. These rebellions rapidly collapsed as William moved against them, building castles and installing garrisons as he had already done in the south. Edwin and Morcar again submitted, while Gospatric fled to Scotland, as did Edgar the Atheling and his family, who may have been involved in these revolts. Meanwhile, Harold's sons, who had taken refuge in Ireland, raided Somerset, Devon and Cornwall from the sea revolts of 1069. Main article, harrying of the north. The remains of Bale Hill, the second Mott and Bailey castle built by William in York. Early in 1069, the newly installed Norman Earl of Northumbria, Robert de Comines, and several hundred soldiers accompanying him were massacred at Durham. The Northumbrian rebellion was joined by Edgar, Gospatric, Seward Barne and other rebels who had taken refuge in Scotland. The Castellan of York, Robert Fitzrichard, was defeated and killed, and the rebels besieged the Norman castle at York. William hurried north with an army, defeated the rebels outside York and pursued them into the city, massacring the inhabitants and bringing the revolt to an end. He built a second castle at York, strengthened Norman forces in Northumbria and then returned south. A subsequent local uprising was crushed by the garrison of York. Harold's sons launched a second raid from Ireland and were defeated in Devon by Norman forces under Count Brian, a son of Oud, Count of Penthièvre. In August or September 1069, a large fleet sent by Swain II of Denmark arrived off the coast of England, sparking a new wave of rebellions. Across the country, after abortive raids in the south, the Danes joined forces with a new Northumbrian uprising, which was also joined by Edgar, Gospatric and the other exiles from Scotland as well as Waltheof. The combined Danish and English forces defeated the Norman garrison at York, seized the castles and took control of Northumbria, although a raid into Lincolnshire led by Edgar was defeated by the Norman garrison of Lincoln. At the same time, resistance flared up again in western Mercia, where the forces of Edric the Wild, together with his Welsh allies and further rebel forces from Cheshire and Shropshire, attacked the castle at Shrewsbury in the southwest. Rebels from Devon and Cornwall attacked the Norman garrison at Exeter, but were repulsed by the defenders and scattered by a Norman relief force under Count Brian. Other rebels from Dorset, Somerset and neighbouring areas besieged Montacute Castle but were defeated by a Norman army gathered from London, Winchester and Salisbury under Geoffrey of Coutances. Meanwhile, William attacked the Danes, who had moored for the winter south of the Humber in Lincolnshire, and drove them back to the north bank, leaving Robert of Mortain in charge of Lincolnshire. He turned west and defeated the Mercian rebels in battle at Stafford. When the Danes attempted to return to Lincolnshire, the Norman forces there again drove them back across the Humber. William advanced into Northumbria, defeating an attempt to block his crossing of the swollen River Aire at Pontefract. The Danes fled at his approach, and he occupied York. He bought off the Danes, who agreed to leave England. In the spring, and during the winter of 1069-70, his forces systematically devastated Northumbria in the harrying of the north, subduing all resistance as a symbol of his renewed authority over the north. William ceremonially wore his crown at York on Christmas Day 1069. In early 1070, having secured the submission of Waltheof and Gospatric, and driven Edgar and his remaining supporters back to Scotland, William returned to Mercia, where he based himself at Chester and crushed all remaining resistance in the area before returning to the south. papal legates arrived and at Easter re-crowned William, which would have symbolically reasserted his right to the kingdom. William also oversaw a purge of prelates from the church, most notably Stigand, who was deposed from Canterbury. The papal legates also imposed penances on William and those of his supporters who had taken part in Hastings and the subsequent campaigns as well as Canterbury. The See of York had become vacant following the death of Ealdred in September 1069. Both sees were filled by men loyal to William. Lanfranc, abbot of William's foundation at Caen, received Canterbury, while Thomas of Bayeux, one of William's chaplains, was installed at York. Some other bishoprics and abbeys also received new bishops and abbots, and William confiscated some of the wealth of the English monasteries, which had served as repositories for the assets of the native nobles' Danish troubles. Coin of Swain II of Denmark in 1070. Swain II of Denmark arrived to take personal command of his fleet and renounced the earlier agreement to withdraw, sending troops into the fens to join forces with English rebels led by Hereward the Wake, at that time based on the Isle of Ely. Swain soon accepted a further payment of Danegeld from William, and returned home after the departure of the Danes. The Fenland rebels remained at large, protected by the marshes, and early in 1071 there was a final outbreak of rebel activity in the area. Edwin and Morcar again turned against William, and although Edwin was quickly betrayed and killed, Morcar reached Ely, where he and Hereward were joined by exiled rebels who had sailed from Scotland. William arrived with an army and a fleet to finish off this last pocket of resistance. After some costly failures, the Normans managed to construct a pontoon to reach the Isle of Ely, defeated the rebels at the bridgehead and stormed the island, marking the effective end of English resistance. Morcar was imprisoned for the rest of his life. Hereward was pardoned and had his lands returned to him. Last Resistance main article, Revolt of the Earls. William faced difficulties in his continental possessions in 1071, but in 1072 he returned to England and marched north to confront King Malcolm III of Scotland. This campaign, which included a land army supported by a fleet, resulted in the Treaty of Abernethy, in which Malcolm expelled Edgar the Atheling from Scotland and agreed to some degree of subordination to William. The exact status of this subordination was unclear. And the aftermath of the rebellion, celebrating Christmas at Winchester. Roger and Walthuf were kept in prison, where Walthuf was executed in May 1076. By that time William had returned to the continent, where Ralph was continuing the rebellion from Brittany. Control of England. The Tower of London, originally begun by William the Conqueror to control London once England had been conquered. The Normans faced many challenges in maintaining control. They were few in number compared to the native English population, including those from other parts of France. Historians estimate the number of Norman landholders at around 8,000. William's followers expected and received lands and titles in return for their service in the invasion, but William claimed ultimate possession of the land in England over which his armies had given him de facto control, and asserted the right to dispose of it as he saw fit. Henceforth, all land was held directly from the king in feudal tenure in return for military service. A Norman lord typically had properties located in a piecemeal fashion throughout England and Normandy, and not in a single geographic block. To find the lands to compensate his Norman followers, William initially confiscated the estates of all the English lords who had fought and died with Harold and redistributed part of their lands. These confiscations led to revolts, which resulted in more confiscations, a cycle that continued for 5 years after the Battle of Hastings to put down and prevent further rebellions. The Normans constructed castles and fortifications in unprecedented numbers, initially mostly on the motte and bailey pattern. Historian Robert Lydiard remarks that to glance at the urban landscape of Norwich, Durham or Lincoln is to be forcibly reminded of the impact of the Norman invasion. William and his barons also exercised tighter control over inheritance of property by widows and daughters, often forcing marriages to Normans. A measure of William's success in taking control is that, from 1072 until the Capetian conquest of Normandy in 1204, William and his successors were largely absentee rulers. For example, after 1072, William spent more than 75% of his time in France rather than England, while he needed to be personally present in Normandy to defend the realm from foreign invasion and put down internal revolts. He set up royal administrative structures that enabled him to rule England from a distance. Consequences. Elite replacement. A direct consequence of the invasion was the almost total elimination of the old English aristocracy and the loss of English control over the Catholic Church in England. William systematically dispossessed English landowners and conferred their property on his continental followers. The Domesday Book meticulously documents the impact of this colossal program of Expropriation, revealing that by 1086 only about 5% of land in England south of the Tees was left in English hands. Even this tiny residue was further diminished in the decades that followed, the elimination of native landholding being most complete in southern parts of the country. Natives were also removed from high governmental and ecclesiastical office after 1075. All earldoms were held by Normans, and Englishmen were only occasionally appointed as sheriffs. Likewise in the church, senior English office holders were either expelled from their positions or kept in place for their lifetimes and replaced by foreigners when they died. By 1096, no bishopric was held by any Englishman, and English abbots became uncommon, especially in the larger monasteries. English emigration. See also, New England medieval depiction of the Varangian Guard from the 12th century. Madrid skylitzes. Following the conquest, many Anglo-Saxons, including groups of nobles, fled the country for Scotland, Ireland, or Scandinavia. Members of King Harold Godwinson's family sought refuge in Ireland and used their bases in that country for unsuccessful invasions of England. The largest single exodus occurred in the 1070s, when a group of Anglo-Saxons in a fleet of 235 ships sailed for the Byzantine Empire. The empire became a popular destination for many English nobles and soldiers, as the Byzantines were in need of mercenaries. The English became the predominant element in the elite Varangian Guard, until then a largely Scandinavian unit, from which the Emperor's bodyguard was drawn. Some of the English migrants were settled in Byzantine frontier regions on the Black Sea coast, and established towns with names such as New London and New York. Governmental systems. Page from the Warwickshire Domesday Survey. Before the Normans arrived, Anglo-Saxon governmental systems were more sophisticated than their counterparts in Norman. All of England was divided into administrative units called shires, with subdivisions. The royal court was the centre of government, and a justice system based on local and regional tribunals existed to secure the rights of free men. Shires were run by officials known as shire reeves or sheriffs. Most medieval governments were always on the move, holding court wherever the weather and food or other matters were best at the moment. England had a permanent treasury at Winchester before William's conquest. One major reason for the strength of the English monarchy was the wealth of the kingdom, built on the English system of taxation that included a land tax, or the geld. English coinage was also superior to most of the other currency in use in northwestern Europe, and the ability to mint coins was a royal monopoly. The English kings had also developed the system than those in the landholding class, so no conclusions can be drawn about peasant women's status after 1066. Noblewomen appear to have continued to influence political life mainly through their kinship relationships. Both before and after 1066, aristocratic women could own land, and some women continued to have the ability to dispose of their property as they wished. Historiography. Debate over the conquest started almost immediately. The Anglo-Saxon Chronicle, when discussing the death of William the Conqueror, denounced him and the conquest in verse, but the king's obituary notice from William of Poitiers, a Frenchman, was full of praise. Historians since then have argued over the facts of the matter and how to interpret them, with little agreement. The theory or myth of the Norman yoke arose in the 17th century, the idea that Anglo-Saxon society had been freer and more equal than the society that emerged after the conquest. This theory owes more to the period it was developed in than to historical facts, but it continues to be used in both political and popular thought to the present day. In the 20th and 21st century, historians have focused less on the rightness or wrongness of the conquest itself, instead concentrating on the effects of the invasion. Some, such as Richard Southern, have seen the conquest as a critical turning point in history. Southern stated that no country in Europe, between the rise of the barbarian kingdoms and the 20th century, has undergone so radical a change in so short a time as England experienced after 1066. Other historians, such as H. G. Richardson and G. O. Sales, believe that the transformation was less radical in more general terms. Singman has called the conquest the last echo of the national migrations that characterized the early Middle Ages. The debate over the impact of the conquest depends on how change after 1066 is measured. If Anglo-Saxon England was already evolving before the invasion, with the introduction of feudalism, castles or other changes in society, then the conquest, while important, did not represent radical reform, but the change was dramatic if measured by the elimination of the English nobility or the loss of Old English as a literary language. Nationalistic arguments have been made on both sides of the debate, with the Normans cast as either the persecutors of the English English or the rescuers of the country from a decadent Anglo-Saxon nobility notes Carat Harthacnut was the son of King Canute the Great and Emma of Normandy, and thus was the half-brother of Edward the Confessor. He reigned from 1040 to 1042, and died without children. Harthacnut's father Canute had defeated Aethelred's son Edmund Ironside in 1016 to claim the English throne and marry Aethelred's widow, Emma. After Harthacnut's death in 1042, Magnus began preparations for an invasion of England, which was only stopped by his own death in 1047. Carat other contenders later came to the fore. The first was Edgar Atheling, Edward the Confessor's great-nephew, who was a patrilineal descendant of King Edmund Ironside. He was the son of Edward the Exile, son of Edmund Ironside, and was born in Hungary, where his father had fled after the conquest of England by Canute after his family's eventual return to England and his father's death in 1057. Edgar had by far the strongest hereditary claim to the throne, but he was only about 13 or 14 at the time of Edward the Confessor's death, and with little family to support him, his claim was passed over by the Witan. Another contender was Swain II of Denmark, who had a claim to the throne as the grandson of Swain Forkbeard and nephew of Canute, but he did not make his bid for the throne until 1069. Tostig Godwinson's attacks in early 1066 may have been the beginning of a bid for the throne, but after defeat at the hands of Edwin and Morcar and the desertion of most of his followers, he threw his lot in with Harald Hardrada. Carat Tostig, who had been Earl of Northumbria, was expelled from that office by a Northumbrian rebellion in late 1065 after King Edward sided with the rebels. Tostig went into exile in Flanders. Carat, the King of Scotland, Malcolm III, is said to have been Tostig's sworn brother. Carat of those 35, five are known to have died in the battle. Robert of Vidit, Ingenulf of Lagal, Robert Fitzernes, Roger son of Turold, and Typher. Carat, the Bayeux tapestry may possibly depict a papal banner carried by William's forces, but this is not named as such in the tapestry. Carat of these named persons, eight died in the battle. Carat Gospatric had bought the office from William after the death of Copsi, whom William had appointed in 1067. Copsi was murdered in 1068 by Osulf, his rival for power in Northumbria. Carat, although the epithet the Wake has been claimed to be derived from the Wakeful One, the first use of the epithet is from the mid-13th century, and is thus unlikely to have been contemporary. Carat Malcolm, in 1069 or 1070, had married Margaret, sister of Edgar the Atheling. Citations. Carat Bates Normandy before 1066 pp 8-10. Carat Crouch Normans pp 15-16. Carat Bates Normandy before 1066 p 12. Carat Bates Normandy before 1066 pp 20-21. Carat Hallam and Everard Capetian France p 53. Carat Williams Aethelred the Unready p 54. Carat Huscroft ruling England p 3. Carat Stafford unification and conquest pp 86-99. Carat A. B. Higham death of Anglo-Saxon England pp 167-181. Carat Walker Harold pp 136-138. Carat Bates William the Conqueror pp 73-77. Carat Higham death of Anglo-Saxon England pp 188-190. Carat Keynes Harthacnut Blackwell Encyclopedia of Anglo-Saxon England. Carat Huscroft Norman Conquest p 84. Carat Stenton Anglo-Saxon England pp 423-424. Carat Huscroft ruling England pp 12-14. Carat Huscroft Norman Conquest pp 96-97. Carat Huscroft Norman Conquest pp 132-133. Carat Stafford unification and conquest pp 86-87. Carat Bates William the Conqueror pp 103-104. Carat Thomas Norman Conquest pp 33-34. Carat A. B. Stenton Anglo-Saxon England pp 578-580. Carat Walker Harold pp 144-145. Carat Walker Harold pp 144-150. Carat Walker Harold pp 154-158. Carat Marin 1066 pp 65-71. Carat Marin 1066 p 73. Carat A. B. Walker Harold pp 158-165. Carat Marin 1066 pp 74-75. Carat A. B. Bates William the Conqueror pp 79-89. Carat Douglas William the Conqueror p 192. Carat A. B. C. D. Gravett Hastings pp 20 20-21 carat Bennett campaigns of the Norman Conquest p25 carat AB Lawson Battle of Hastings pp 163-164 carat Bennett campaigns of the Norman Conquest p26 carat Marin 1066 pp 89-90 carat Gravitt Hastings p27 carat Marin 1066 pp 108-109 carat ABC Marin 1066 pp 107-108 carat AB Huscroft Norman Conquest pp 120-123 carat Marin 1066 p 98 carat Carpenter Struggle for Mastery p 72 carat Marin 1066 p 93 carat Huscroft Norman Conquest p 124 carat Lawson Battle of Hastings pp 180-182 carat Marin 1066 pp 99-100 carat Lawson Battle of Hastings p 128 carat Lawson Battle of Hastings pp 130-133 carat AB Gravitt Hastings pp 28-34 carat Marin 1066 p 105 carat Huscroft Norman Conquest p 126 carat Carpenter Struggle for Mastery p 73 carat Huscroft Norman Conquest pp 127-128 carat Huscroft Norman Conquest p 129 carat Marin 1066 p 137 carat Gravitt Hastings p 77 carat Gravitt Hastings p 80 carat ABC Huscroft Norman Conquest p 131 carat AB Gravitt Hastings p 81 carat Marin 1066 p 146 carat Bennett campaigns of the Norman Conquest p 91 carat Douglas William the Conqueror pp 204-205 carat AB Douglas William the Conqueror pp 205-206 carat Gravitt Hastings p 84 carat ABC Huscroft Norman Conquest pp 138-139 carat ABC Douglas William the Conqueror p 212 carat Williams Edric the Wild Oxford Dictionary of National Biography carat Walker Harold pp 186-190 carat AB Huscroft Norman Conquest pp 140-141 carat ABC Huscroft Norman Conquest pp 142-144 carat Douglas William the Conqueror pp 214-215 carat Williams English and the Norman Conquest pp 24-27 carat Williams English and the Norman Conquest pp 20-21 carat AB Williams English and the Norman Conquest pp 27-34 carat Williams English and the Norman Conquest p 35 carat ABCD Williams English and the Norman Conquest pp 35-41 carat Huscroft Norman Conquest pp 145-146 carat Bennett campaigns of the Norman Conquest p 56 carat Roth Harroward Oxford Dictionary of National Biography carat Douglas William the Conqueror pp 221-222 carat Williams English and the Norman Conquest pp 49-57 carat AB Huscroft Norman Conquest pp 146-147 carat Douglas William the Conqueror pp 225-226 carat Douglas William the Conqueror p 227 carat ABC Douglas William the Conqueror pp 231-233 carat Bates William the Conqueror pp 181-182 carat Douglas William the Conqueror p 216 and footnote 4 carat Stafford Unification and Conquest pp 102-105 carat Carpenter Struggle for Mastery pp 82-83 carat AB Carpenter Struggle for Mastery pp 79-80 carat AB Carpenter Struggle for Mastery p 84 carat Carpenter Struggle for Mastery pp 83-84 carat Carpenter Struggle for Mastery pp 75-76 carat Chibnall Anglo-Norman England pp 11-13 carat Kaufman and Kaufman Medieval Fortress p 110 carat Lydiard Castles in Context p 36 carat Carpenter Struggle for Mastery p 89 carat Carpenter Struggle for Mastery p 91 carat Thomas English and Normans pp 105-137 carat Thomas Significance English Historical Review pp 303-333 carat Thomas English and Normans pp 202-208 carat ABC Sigar Western Travelers pp 140-141 carat AB Daniel from from Norman conquest to Magna Carta pp 13-14 Heath Byzantine armies p 23 Thomas Norman conquest p 59 Huscroft Norman conquest p 187 A B Loyne governance of Anglo-Saxon England p 176 A B Thomas Norman conquest p 60 Huscroft Norman conquest p 31 Carat Huscroft Norman conquest pp 194-195 Carat Huscroft Norman conquest pp 36-37 Carat Huscroft Norman conquest pp 198-199 Carat Keynes Charters and Writs Blackwell Encyclopedia of Anglo-Saxon England p 100 Carat Huscroft Norman conquest pp 200-201 Carat Huscroft Norman conquest pp 323-324 Carat Crystal Story of Middle English English language Carat Huscroft Norman conquest pp 321-322 Carat Thomas Norman conquest pp 107-109 Carat AB Huscroft Norman conquest p 327 Carat AB Clanchy England and its rulers p 93 Carat Huscroft ruling England p 94 Carat Huscroft Norman conquest p 329 Carat Huscroft Norman conquest pp 281-283 Carat ABCD Clanchy England and its rulers pp 31-35 Chibnall debate p 6 Carat Chibnall debate p 38 Huscroft Norman conquest pp 318-319 quoted in Clanchy England and its rulers p 32 Singman Daily Life PXV references Bates, David 1982 Normandy before 1066 London, Longman ISBN